Welcome, everybody. I'm going to talk about a mobility as a service use case from the Netherlands. First, I want to discuss a little bit on why do you need APIs for a use case like this, and why this particular organization wants to use APIs for it. Then we'll talk about who were involved. I will quickly introduce ourselves and the bus company that was involved. What did we accomplish with this project? How did we do that, more from a technical perspective? And then some conclusions and next steps. And the interesting part is that the next speaker that's talking about the mobility as a service is actually one of the apps that connected to this platform back in the Netherlands. So it gives a nice story, I think, from the bus company perspective and from the mobile app builder perspective. So first, a little bit of it's like just ignore the advertisement, but it explains in a nice way, I think, why in public transport in the Netherlands we want APIs.
It's getting too busy on the road, train, bus, and even on water. Connexion called on eProcede to build a platform that allows seamless integration of its mobile offerings and those of its partners. As a result, travellers will be provided with a complete mobile door-to-door service based on their personal situation and real-time traffic information. Together, we created Mobility as a Service.
I don't know how it's here. This is my first visit, actually, to Finland. And I noticed in Helsinki you have a very good public transport network. I took the bus, I took the train, I took a boat. In the Netherlands, we have a lot of traffic jams, and it's a real issue. And often people cannot just rely on the public transport because they live in an area where there's not that many buses, or they have to go to an office that's like in an industrial area where there's no buses. So basically what you really want is an end-to-end experience to give people options based on the traffic and your personal preferences. So basically for the bus company that we're talking about here, which is Transdev, it's a French-owned company that has buses and other modes of transport in different countries, they want to offer more options for travelers. So not just their bus, but also other ways of transportation, and give them better and more accurate information during the trip. Because maybe when I plan to get here and I need to be on time for my talk, I take a bus but I get into a traffic jam, I want to know that before I get on the bus. I don't know that day before, but it needs to be very up-to-date, and then I need some alternatives, right? So if something happens. Of course, for society, this is really important. In the Netherlands, it's a real issue. We're completely stuck. We have the headquarters in Luxembourg. When my colleagues visit Utrecht, they make a joke. You break when you hit the border, and then you just wait until you can move like an inch per hour or something like that, right? So we really need some solutions to solve our traffic issues and parking issues. I noticed you guys have a solution here as well. We parked on Saturday at Stockman, and I don't want to think about the amount of money you have to pay when you park here. But I guess in Helsinki you have similar issues, right? That you need to make sure that your traffic issues are solved, and that you can only do that if you actually have a very good service to your travelers. You cannot just tell people you have to use public transportation or you have to do that. You have to offer the services that go along with that. And then, of course, since it's a bus company, they want to make a profit. In their mind, they would sell more tickets. Because if you sell better service and you have better options, better information available, more people that would normally not take a bus as part of their journey now will take a bus. And I will discuss a little bit of these examples at the end of this presentation that is actually happening right now in the Netherlands. Today, actually, at another congress. So the mobility as a service, I think, is a no-brainer. Everybody's talking about it when you're talking about transport. But why would you need an API platform for that? Well, first of all, of course, if you want to build a mobility as a service offering, then you need to have information, and it needs to be available. So you need to know about the ticket price, you need to know about the routes, you need to know about traffic information. And that information needs to be reliable, right? So you have to know that it's correct. So this bus company offers this information. They have it in their back office. But it's in different systems and in different formats. So when you're a mobile app builder, you don't want to get started with huge files of XML or with strange ways of explaining a journey. When you dive into public transportation, they have very convoluted ways of explaining routes. You have the physical route and a geographical route and where you can drive on the road and where you actually are with the coordinates. So it needs to be easy to consume for a mobile app builder. So it needs to be consumable as well. You also want to control it, right? You want to make sure that information that is public to everybody, but information about bus drivers' shifts, for example, you don't want to expose that to the internet, right? It's none of anybody's business when a bus driver has a shift or not. So you want to be able to control access to an API. Some is accessible to everyone. Some is accessible to people that have a contract with the bus company, and some is open data. So it's very important to make sure you know who can access your data and who doesn't. And it ties nicely into the previous presentation, of course, is you need to be able to authenticate and authorize people on the APIs. It also needs to be scalable. We think that mobility as a service is really going to grow fast. So right now, there might be only a little small number of providers that offer these types of services. But in the vision of the bus company and also of us, we think this is going to grow really quickly in the world, not just in the Netherlands. As I said, the next speaker, I think, is from Finland. And so it's a thing here as well and in other countries. The ecosystem is growing, so you need to keep track. Who's actually connecting to my API, and are they doing something with it? We had a couple of companies that were interested, connected to the platform, but then never did anything with it. You want to make sure that you also remove them from your list, from your systems, and that you can keep track of that, and not just publish APIs and don't know if anybody's using it, whether they like it or not, and so you need to evolve them. And so it's nice if you have a visibility over the ecosystem. And in this case, it offers easy centralized access to open data. In the Netherlands right now, you can get a list of all the bus stops, or actually all the stops in the Netherlands. It's an XML list of I don't know how many megabytes that is updated every day. When you're a mobile app builder and you want to find the next bus stop, you don't want to go parse that daily updated XML file and present that in your app. So what the bus company did is they created some APIs that make the information that is already available in the Netherlands easily available as an API rather than some convoluted XML format or a very complicated standard. So basically that is why they wanted to create the API platform. Who's they? Well, first of all, as I said already, Transdev, it's a big company. They started this in the Netherlands, which is, of course, much smaller. And they have a brand there. It's called Connection. And excuse me. They have a lot of buses that they run. It's a big, as I said, it's a big company headquartered in Luxembourg. I'm from Eperseed. Eperseed has its headquarters in Luxembourg. We have local offices in several parts of the world. One of them is the Netherlands. I'm from there, so I traveled here. We don't have any offices right now in the Nordics yet, but we're growing quickly. And usually we use Oracle tooling to build our solutions. And that was the case in this use case as well. We have support services, consultancy services, and some products. And I am CTO at Eperseed together with Fabien Haria. And I've been working in software since, well, for a long time. I won't say how long because it makes me feel old, but I've been doing this for a while. So I guess it's clear why we want the APIs for mobility as a service. Who did that? It was Transdev together with Eperseed. So what did we actually create? So basically what we created is three APIs. That's what we started with. We didn't want to start with a really humongous design project and think about it for a year and then start doing some stuff. So we said, okay, let's do three APIs. We start with that. We start using them. Also in the bus, right? Let's see how that goes. Do people understand? Do they have the mobile app? How does it go with the bus driver? How do we validate? So they started with three APIs. One for routes and detours for bus drivers. The other one to generate tickets, like you have in your HSL app, the barcode tickets, and one to tell people the nearest bus stop. It's based on standards. There's lots of standards in public transport. There's also a lot of standards around APIs, of course. So we use the API standards as much as possible. And then basically, when you look at an API platform, you have three roles. One is the provider, so the owner of the API, in this case, Connexion or Transdev. Then you have the consumers, the mobile app builders that want to use the APIs. And then, of course, the developers, the API developers. In this case, that was us. And this platform that we used offers different functionalities for the different roles that you have. And you can also manage these roles in the platform. First of all, of course, Connexion wants to be able to secure the APIs. For the nearest bus stop, it's not a big issue. Everybody is allowed to know, of course, what is the nearest bus stop. But for example, for the tickets, you only want people that you trust and that have good that you have a contract with to sell your tickets. They for Connexion, this was a new sales channel. Because instead of just selling the tickets in the bus or going to their website and get a ticket, you can now download a mobile app. And they can sell the tickets there. Or for a conference, you can buy a ticket for the conference and then get a ticket for the bus as well. That means they have a new business channel, but they only want to do that with the people that they actually partnered with, right? It's a B2B application, so they want to secure it. They want to publish it because the developers of those mobile apps, they need to know how the API works. So it's important to publish them and to have the documentation around that. And inside the news. It's, of course, back in the days when you still had like service-oriented architecture or other integration styles, so to speak, it was hard to know whether something was used, how it was used, and what was the easiest thing for people to use. Basically, what this platform should provide is, and what we have in the platform is insight. Who used it? How often do we get an exception? Do they understand it? Because it's really interesting to see, for example, that we... In the ordering process, where the most mistakes are made, what are the most common errors in the calls to the APIs? Because apparently, either our API is too complicated, or our documentation is incorrect. Right? So it's really not just from a business perspective, but also from a usability perspective of the API, really good to see how it's used and what is used most. And then in the future, they want to be able to monetize. So right now, they don't charge for the use of the API. So any mobile app builder that has access and is allowed on the platform can use, for example, the routes and detours API as much as they want. But you can imagine that in the future, they might be able to monetize it. And so you can define plans where you can start doing that with the platform. Now, for the consumers, of course, you have the documentation. So there's a developer portal, an SDK to start developing the API based on the API definition, and a way to test it. And then, of course, to actually call it runtime. That's also important. For us, the platform is a place where we also develop and test it. We do the troubleshooting and monitoring with the platform. The documentation we do, we use Apiary for that, and all the platform services that go with it, security, scalability, upgrades, backup, and recovery, all those types of things. So we have the API platform. I think it's pretty complete. I'm really interested in seeing the rest of the sessions and see what, you know, other platforms are supposed to offer and offer. But this was the parts that we realized. So how did we do that? Basically, we used the Oracle platform, a cloud service for that, and we used four components. Now, Oracle has a platform in the cloud. I know not a lot of people know that. Of course, AWS and Azure are more known. But Oracle has actually a very, I think, well-designed API platform. And we use the mobile cloud services for the business logic, for location-based services, and to generate the barcode. the API platform service for the documentation and security of the platform and the analytics and the monitoring. Identity cloud service for OAuth and user management of the passwords. People can get access to the developer portal. We can see how many people are logging in, making mistakes. So we're also supporting the platform. So before somebody calls and says, I get this error all the time, we can say, yeah, we can see that because we see that you have a lot of failed login attempts with your app. And then the API gateway on a compute cloud. The API gateway you can deploy anywhere. So you can deploy it close to where your business logic is sitting. In this case, we deployed it also in the cloud because our business logic was in the cloud. So here you see the overview. So at the left, you can see the consumers. So the first one is the browser. That's actually you guys, right, if you're an API developer. A mobile developer, for example, then you go to the developer portal and there you find all the information that you need about the APIs that Transdev is offering to mobile app developers. And you can take a look at the documentation, you can test it on a mock server, and you can subscribe to the ones that you want access to. Now, if you are allowed, if you get the access, then you can actually use it runtime on the gateway node. So if you want to just browse and test them and see how it works, then you can do that on the developer portal. There's no restriction there, except you have to have access to the developer portal. If you actually want to start using it from your mobile app, you would subscribe to the API, and once you get access, you can use it. We designed the APIs in Apiary. You can do Swagger or OpenAPI Blueprint there. We have three, as I said. Sorry, there's still some Dutch there. And then there's a management portal. In the management portal, you put the security on your APIs. You publish the APIs. You accept people who subscribe to the APIs. You can see the analytics, so how often it is used. So there, basically, you manage what you want to do with your API. And once you're ready and you tested it well, you can deploy it to the gateway node and it can actually be used. Then it uses the Identity Cloud as an OAuth provider for the ones that are secure. So to the left, you can see the apps. So here, an end user, a traveler, like you guys that go with a bus in the Netherlands, if you land in Schiphol and you would have downloaded Wim or the GoBout app, basically what it will do is it will contact the APIs on the gateway node, get information about the possible tickets that you can buy from the mobile cloud service, get the nearest bus stop if you need. And then in the management portal, we can see the usage of those different apps, not of the traveler. So there's no travel information there, right? I don't see a person. I see the app and how often. So we can also compare between the different apps, who sells more tickets, what are the type of tickets that they sell, and all those types of things. So this is a screenshot of the first version of the API management portal that we used. We're currently at a third version of the sales API. As I said, we started this with a small group, a couple of app builders, to test how do we want to use the API, how does it work in the bus, do we get, you know, obstruction and lines when people get in the bus and they need to fiddle with their ticket. And so they were really trying it out. So we're now adding some more functionality for different types of tickets. So the sales API has changed a bit in the last couple of months. And here you can see the implementation and the policies that you can put on there. And we had an interesting issue is that we had a policy to limit how many calls you can do. Because if people start doing a lot of calls, the bus company starts paying for the PaaS platform more because you pay per message. So we wanted to make sure that nobody was just, you know, hitting the service for no good reason. However, when you do automated tests, of course, your number of API calls per hour goes up really quickly compared to what you have in production. So we now created two plans, one for production and one for test. And in a test, you can have more calls per hour than in production, because in test, it is logical that you would have a whole bunch that you fire up at it, which usually doesn't happen in production. You can do also some filtering of the headers and routing and stuff like that. And then it from the developer portal, you have a similar view on the APIs. When you click on it, you get the Swagger documentation, and you can subscribe there. You also have analytics, so you can see it your own use of the API if you want. You can add your colleagues to it, so they get access. So basically, as a consumer of the API, you can also manage a little bit who can access and what they can do with that. So very briefly about the APIs we built. I think this one is a nice one. Is we can generate a barcode ticket for travelers who want to get a ticket. It's secured with OAuth. One of the issues that we had is that the standard for reading the barcodes in the bus, it's based on a very old standard that doesn't understand UTF-8. And we were doing Node. And Node basically only understands UTF-8, right? So we were struggling a lot because we had these sort of old-fashioned standards. The railroad standards have been around for a long, long time. And for the life of us, we didn't understand why doesn't it understand this signed barcode. We can read it. I wrote a Java program to figure it out because Java is a little bit easier when it comes to typing. And then I noticed, oh, there's somewhere in Node is some library creating the UTF-8 all the time, even though we said it was something different. We managed, but it's sometimes hard when you have standards. It's really nice, but because they often are a bit lagging compared to the frameworks you're using, that was it gave us a headache. So the apps look like this, so you get the barcode. It looks like what you have as well. It's not that exciting, I guess. And you can buy a ticket. So for the stopping places, I already mentioned that. It's really large XML files that we had to parse. So we wanted a really fast parser. Now, a lot of the Node.js parsers that we could find, they had some Python and OS-specific code in there. A lot of our developers develop on Windows, and then they would upload something. So there was also some challenges we had to take into account. And then locations. There's different ways of defining a location, depending on how specific you want to be. And then we had an app for bus drivers. So they, when they start the journey, they can see the detours, the routes, and the detours were in GraphQL. So basically at the back, we had the GraphQL, the builders, the mobile app builders, they didn't want all that flexibility. They just wanted to have three screens. Give me all the detours of this journey and all the bus stops that are changed. They didn't want to make these convoluted queries. So basically in the back, we had the GraphQL, and in the front, we offered simple REST APIs. And I think if people are around and feel like explaining to me why we would always use GraphQL, I'm happy to listen to that, but I think it has some downsides, but it's an interesting discussion, I think. The versioning, I think somebody else is talking about that this afternoon, so I'm really interested in that. And adding OAuth to the documentation, 99% of all of our questions, maybe 99.999, from mobile app builders are about the OAuth. How to connect, how to get the token, how to encrypt. It's a standard, but there's still different ways of doing it. Each provider does it in a slightly different way, so that is a challenge. I think this channel for the bus company has been very successful. They're now experimenting with other things like events, like a ticket to a soccer game, and now you get the bus ticket with it. That was a success. Right now there's a conference going on, and people get the tickets for the bus with the conference tickets. We have multiple providers that are connecting, and we're improving the APIs. I think I'm running out of time, so I hope to talk to you guys if you are interested these 2 days.